Children are turning against their parents and parents against their children and so on and so forth. So we see those things that are happening every day. And if you don't know the Lord is soon to come, then there's something wrong with you, because I mean that the world is getting worse and worse every day. Amen. And so that's why we need to stick close to the bunch, isn't it? Amen. I said, one banana said to the other, stick close to the bunch and you won't get peeled. I guess that's a Sister Betty.
That's a Betty idea.
I never went to Sister Betty's, but I hear all the little bitty things from Brother Pat. I got saved in this church, and Brother Pat got saved in Sister Betty's church. So. It's totally, you know, all those little isms and sisms that she had, he says them from time to time. And that's just like Sister Jennifer says, I say brother things that Brother Pat said through the years, you know. So if you'll stand, we're going to get opened up.
Sorry, Wendy.
Brother Chuck, why don't you open our service this evening?
Thank you.
my prayer. Hallelujah.
Oh, I want to see him. Page 279. I do want to see him.
What are the high ones?
Huh?
High ones.
High ones. High D. High. He's high.
I'm a C singer. I'm a band singer.
Okay, ready, D. Children.
Ready?
G.
going to help you push.
Amen.
God is so good.
Yes,
amen.
He is.
Hallelujah. Yes, he is. He is good all the time. Amen. Thank God, hallelujah, that he is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, that God does not change. Amen. We're going to take our prayer requests at this time. Please remember Brother Pat. Brother Mark and I were talking, and I'm sure that those who's been out to see me, he's never been a nervous type person, but he seems like he's very, very nervous. His feet and legs are going continuously almost all the time, and if he's got the blanket on him, he's fidgeting with the blanket, you know. But he's never been like that, and so it's hard to see him in that, you know, like that. And the other day that he was really talking, you know, sort of silly, and I was talking to one of the ladies that works out there in administration, and I said, "This is not my husband," and he heard me. Yes, it is your husband. But so anyway, just remembering he's doing well, doing very well, and he as the paint, he's been 117 South Wing at Grandview, right next to the hospital. 107. I said 117. It's 107. See, I don't know. That wouldn't have been my husband. I haven't been to see anybody but my husband. I know which room it is. I know which room it is anyway. I did go see Sister Betty the other day. Yes, I did. I went and seen Sister Betty and visited with her for a while. And she said, I know you. I know I do. I said, I'm Brother Pat's wife, Sister Dick. Oh, yes. But anyway, she had asked about Brother Pat and everything. And she'd even asked someone that, you know, was in my distant family, that he goes out and visits anywhere from 30 to 40 people a day. And so he had stopped by. And he said, Sister Betty wanted to know what room you were in and everything and how you were doing. Because she knew he was coming. Because someone at Sister Erlene or somebody had told her that he was coming out there. So, and Jean said, no, he's not here yet. I don't think he just had his surgery. And so he'll be here in a few days. But anyway, so remember Sister Betty too. And I got a call today from a gentleman whose name is Jim. I'm not wanting to tell you his last name, but his name is Jim. And he asked us to please remember him. Him and his wife is going through some marital problems right now because of granddaughter, and it's just really, really sad situation. And so anyway, he really desires our prayers, and he is going to a church in Indianapolis. Brother Pat's always been a counselor to him, and so he usually calls when he's in dire trouble and talks to Brother Pat. And so Brother Pat, of course, went home, so I gotta hear everything today, and tried to listen and be understanding. And you know, there's always it's never one-sided. You know, there's always two stories to everything. So anyway, just remember Jim and his family. His wife's name is Kathy, and actually Brother Pat married him you know, a few years ago. So just remember that situation. Sister Caroline. Yes, absolutely.
She helped me wrap every one of those gifts this week. And while we was doing that, she said, Mama, she starts crying. She said, I want you to pray for my mom and dad is getting divorced. And I don't want to, you know. And cried. It just broke my heart.
I know. She did. Me too. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, she told me, and it is sad. It's very, very hard on the children. Brother Chad. Mark's very happy. Amen. Brother Dennis.
Oh, pray for me. After my surgery, I had back a stuff on my stomach still getting fit. Pray for me all that's getting better. Pray for the homeless place. Pray for everybody.
All right.
Sister George? Remember all the kids' parents that passed the building that Friday? And remember the Swango family that Jenny's cousin passed, Marvin? He had that surgery, he never did come out of it. So, he's coming here. Florida that she could get bought again. And they had bought plots 2 months ago for some odd reason. She said she got ready to buy their plots. And so they're having very here. So remember that family just died. And then you remember since we had American Dodge.
You know, when people lose loved ones, it's always very, very hard at the holidays time. And especially when you lose them near Christmas, it just seems like, I know my daughter died the 20th of December and was buried the 22nd of December. And my Christmas that year was a black dress, you know. So at this time of year, I always think about, you know, I mean, it is a sad time. And that's been 15 years ago. Seems impossible, but it's been 50 years. But how? I promise you, Mother, I am leaving that church at 6 o'clock. I will be there. She's thinking about giving her notice. We need her, don't we, Sister Bobby?
I would have been here, but anyway, we'll talk about that later.
Amen. Brother Dennis, you got another one? Absolutely, absolutely. Someone else have a Sister Thelma.
I call for one of my cousins, and I'll ask another cousin to drop the name of Thelma.
Is that on the rental sign? On the white sign? Sit down with my relation, if you don't know that.
Daddy's
niece. Yeah. Okay.
Sorry. I remember Paul Huff. I found out about the survey that they're going to do. I told you they're going to have two surgeons in there. Well, one's going to be working on the front side of the spine, and the other one's going to be working on the back side of the spine.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, he's going to be completely wide open. But I talked to Sue the other day on the desk. I talked to his sister, and she said she's completely clear.
Thank you.
it will be a medical discharge, right? Yeah. You'll find something.
Remember that, and also remember the situation where my
Sister Marie.
Yes, I'd like to ask for prayer. If I had a young man that was staying with me at one time, he was released from jail and had no place to go, and he was a total stranger to me, and he came to me and asked me if he could please stay at the house. And I said yes. And he stayed with me, and he got on his feet, and he moved out, and he got back to his old way. Now he's back in jail. And he wrote me and he told me for the first time since I've talked to him that he was talking about the churches that have been going to there and they had brought him food baskets and all that. And he's been going to church. And his whole language has changed. He's talking about God now and all this. And I just hope, you know, everybody finds God when they're in jail.
Jailhouse religion.
And I just called for prayer that stays with him when he gets out.
Amen.
He wanted to know if you could come and stay with me when he gets out so he gets back on his feet. I have not given him an answer because I don't think I can go through it again. I just pray that, you know, he said I'm the only one that writes to him. He thinks of me like his mother, which I know. He always remembers me at Mother's Day and things like that.
They're back in jail again. Absolutely.
I mean, he's got children, and he just, I don't know, all I can say is it's up to God.
Amen. And what's his first name, then?
Jason.
We will remember Jason. Amen. Sister Wanda, you got to, no, okay, Brother Albert.
Yes, Brown. All the ones that have, loved ones that have passed on this time of year, wonderful. And remember our school.
Absolutely.
And our bus drivers, and the ones that passed by the bus drivers on the back roads, like me. I came around this curve one day. I thank God for his protection. I pray every day before I go out. And I've had deer run across from me. I have a little Bambi run this run right beside me. I said, "You stay over there, and I'll stay over here." He did, and I did, and it all worked out good. I came around this curve, and the bus came around, and it was flying around this corner. I'm like, oh, geez. I'm not saying that they're bad drivers, we all need to remember in our prayers that they got young people on the
bus. Amen.
I'm just glad for one point in my life, but I wasn't ready to go when something would happen, but now I'm
Now you're ready.
I'm in our safety, and I thank God for that.
Amen.
My goal is to remember the sick, the addicted, the afflicted, the lost, and dying, all those in the jails, prisons, nursing homes, hospitals, and our troops and their families. And, I mean, there is so numerous, and God knows my heart, and I let Him read the rest of my heart. And He hears our prayers and answers.
Sister Kelman?
My brother Ernie's got pneumonia again at Lawrence Manor for Indianapolis.
Rehearsal Wednesday for our Christmas program, but
so early 15, 20 minutes, if at all possible, we're going to go try to sing a few Christmas carols up and down the hall, okay? Just because in his mind, he thinks that we're all going down there, okay?
So anyway, about 5:45, those that want to, and we will just, for a short time, so, and I mean, the rest of you, if you want to sing longer, you can, but we know those that are in the program need to be back here by 6:30 at the church because we have the...
Earlene will be singing in the dining hall, so you're more than welcome to go in there and sing with her in the dining hall, but we'll just carol the hall. We'll just sing a few songs up and down the hall.
Okay.
Sing at what time?
5:45.
5:45.
And we'll carol the hall, okay?
Okay. So I just wanted to announce that. I almost forgot about it, that he does. And he just forgot that we sang out there with Christmas carol last week. We sang Christmas carols last Wednesday out there, but he was in the hospital still.
He wants to walk with this in here, and that's the whole thing. He wants to walk.
He is doing good, and he really does walk good. So anyway, I don't know how long he can stand on his feet or whatever, but we will sing for a while. Yeah, we could play in a wheelchair. Anybody else have a prayer request?
He was in that class, so all his, some of his classmates got shot.
You had a nephew that was in that class?
Yeah, it missed him just that much. Great nephew.
Great nephew.
Great nephew.
Yeah, missed him about that much. Good missing about that much.
Amen. Unspoken request by the uplifted hand. Let's stand it with you. If you're not able, just sit in your seat and pray along with us. Mighty Saviors, we come before you this night. Truly, we glorify you. We lift you up. look to magnify your holy name. According to your word, Lord, if you be lifted up, you'll draw all men unto thee. And we just glorify you, Lord. We're so thankful, Lord, that we can look unto thee. We ask, Lord, that you just draw by your spirit, Lord, those is, hallelujah, that is out of the house of God, Lord Jesus. And mighty Savior, let our hearts and our mind be open, Lord, that glorify you and lift you up. And remember each and every one of these that lost children, Lord, and lost loved ones in this shooting, Lord. And we know, mighty Savior, that you are the comforter. By you, mighty Savior, are each and every one of us comforted with the loss of our loved ones, Lord. And we just ask, mighty Jesus, that those that sick and afflicted this night, we know that your stripes, so we are healed, that you took our afflictions upon yourself, that we might be able to walk in victory, Lord Jesus. And we just ask, Lord, that your will be done, not, Lord, not ours, that your will be done in each and every one of these situations, Lord Jesus, and with Sister Wendy in this job situation, Lord, that your will be done in it, Lord, that you might receive the praise, the glory, and the honor, Lord Jesus. Just have your way, mighty Savior. We know, Lord, that you're a way maker, for there seemeth to be no way. Remember, Brother Pat, this night, Lord, as we lift him up before you, just have your way, mighty Savior, with each one, Lord. Hallelujah, that sin is lifted this night, mighty Jesus. And hallelujah, we just ask, Lord, that our hearts and our mind be open to and to you this night, Lord, that we might worship you in spirit and truth, Lord, each and every one, Lord Jesus. We give you the praise. Remember this young man, Lord Jesus. And hallelujah, that Sister Marie requested prayer for Jason. We lift him up before you, Lord. We just ask, Lord Jesus, that your will be done. We give the praise and glory and the honor in Jesus' precious name. We ask it. And let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God is so good. Hallelujah. Well, Sister Lori, there you are.
Yeah.
Amen. You're running a little behind,
yeah,
me, but you're here. I knew that we saw you last night. We weren't sure if you were coming from the emergency room or where you were coming from.
Actually, I was here this morning.
Well, I was here this morning, and I know you were here, but I didn't get a chance to talk to you.
Yeah, I was feeling dizzy and lightheaded last night, and I had to go to the emergency room, but the doctor on call said she thinks I might be starting to go through the change.
Oh, okay.
Good luck.
Well, me and Lisa passed you as we were going to the nursing home last night in your little motorized car.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, at least we know what it was.
Yeah.
All right. Sister Caroline, you have a song on your heart tonight?
There's a blessed time is coming, coming soon. It may be evening, morning, brand new. Better new, the wedding of the bride. We shall see the King's wedding night. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. Thank you.
Come, we'll put God upon the shelf like Lisa sings and take him down when we need his help. But if you, this is no different. Your salvation in there, and the jailhouse religion is no different than any other religion that you're sick on Sunday morning and you say, Lord, heal me up and I'll never do it again. And one time, a lot of us, I'm sure, got a hold, oh God, you'll heal me up. And let me get over this big sick hangover. I promise I'll never do it again.
Oh, yeah.
And, that's the way it is in jail. Lord, you get me out. And I done it. Grandma come running down. She was a good holiness preacher, and I'd call her and whine on the phone, and she'd say, honey, you're going to have to get your life right with God. And I'd promise, and she'd come running down and get me out. And I'd do good for a couple of weeks, and I'd be right back. But one time, God got a hold of my heart, and everything changed. And Brother Pat often says, if you have enough courage to step out into the aisle and head this way, I guarantee you God will meet you there if you're sincere in your heart. And it's that way. If you're in a hotel cell and you're really sincere in your heart, God will jump right in there. I was telling somebody the other day, they were, oh, Sister Wanda. They wrote a song when I was locked up, Mama, Jesus is in jail. And it was almost looked like he was telling his mom, you ain't gonna believe it, Jesus went to jail. But really, he was there. And oh, God, he sung that song and I just cried and boy, and carried on. And, when God tenders your heart up, it don't take much to Grandma used to sing us a lot now. I fought Grandma. Brother Pat knows it one way and I know it another, and we both have known it so long that we kind of clash with him. So when he ain't around, I sing. Well, no crown of grace in the eyes. His window in the sky, he said, I created man, but the question is why? There's been nothing but fights since creation day. I think I'll send a little water. So the Lord, he come down, he looked around the spell. Of course, there was Mr. Noah. He was behaving mighty well. And that is the reason that the scripture records that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Well, there's going to be some water and there's going to be some mud. So take off your hat, Noah, and take off the coat, and get Ham, Shem, and Jake out to build yourself a boat. Well, Noah said, Lord, I just don't believe I could. Well, the Lord said, Noah, you can get you some sturdy gopher wood. Because you never know what you can do if you try and make it 50 cubits wide and 30 cubits high. Well, Noah, said, Noah, it's time to get aboard. Take you a creature, a he and a she, and of course Mrs. Noah and the whole family. Well, Noah said, Lord, it's getting awful dark. The Lord said, Noah, get those creatures in the ark. Well, Noah said, Lord, it's starting in the pouring. The Lord said, get in there so I can shut the door. Well, Noah. It rose up from the foot of the deep, and after 40 days, Mr. Noah took the feet. He said, we're not moving, Lord, where are we at? He said, well, you're sitting right on top of Mount Ararat. Oh, yeah, but he said, it's getting awful dry. Well, the Lord said, Noah, do you see my rainbow in the sky? Take all these creatures and get down to earth, and don't be more trouble than you are.
The. Well, then I'm going to have to review just a little bit because I was going to do it anyhow. It doesn't make any difference. I started to go another way tonight rather than this. After this morning service, got checked on it. Boy. Brother Gary, how about just opening this up? I don't know how far we'll get through this teaching aspect of it, but we certainly want the Lord to have His way with it. If you wasn't here Thursday night, you weren't here on any of the Saturday teachings. This is actually Saturday teaching. We teach from 11 to 12. There's no cost. It's free to you. I realize that's a weird time and it messes up your weekend. But involved in that, I want to go over this and make sure that everybody sees it because this is really the heart of it. And I do mean heart of it because some here, some way. And this is not a bullseye. This is symbolizing something, and it's symbolizing who we are. When you were born again, and before you were born again, didn't make any difference. You were the same thing before you were born again, except after you got born again, this red spirit in here is a brand new spirit, brand new nature that's inside of you. It's a brand new creature in Christ. That's who you became when you got born again. And what this other circles represent here, of course, we've got a soul. Bible tells us, 1 Thessalonians 5:23, that your spirit, soul, and body. All right, you're a spirit is who you are. You don't look in the mirror in the morning in the bathroom and see who you are. You see your physical manifestation in the mirror. You don't see the real you. The real you is the spirit man on the inside, is what Scripture tells us. And what I want to basically help you to understand tonight is you can't really see yourself unless you look in here. This is our mirror. This is who we are. This is how we find out who we are. We're everything that this word says that we are. This is my Bible. It was written for me. And it's who I am. And the only way I can understand who I am is to get into it and understand what it says about me, all right? It's personal to each one of us. I cherish my Bible, and that's the reason that I carry it with me wherever I go. But we have a soul, and the soul is made up of our mind, will, and emotions. And you have a mind up here, and it's not this brain, but your mind, this soul, mind, will, and emotions, is what's on the inside of us. And we have a brain in this physical body that operates off senses. The senses that we have, the seeing, the hearing, the smelling, the touching, tasting, those five senses is how our physical body operates and gets those, and our brain tells us what to do. If something's hot, we stick our finger on it, it automatically tells us, remove your finger, what you're touching is hot and it's not good for you. So we remove our finger. So we've got body, soul, and spirit. And this body is nothing more than a physical manifestation that we contact the physical world with. But we're that person on the inside. I want to put up another little illustration for you here, because I just want, this is just another way of looking at it, but it gives you a little bit better understanding that your body doesn't contact your soul. I mean your spirit, I'm sorry. Your spirit doesn't contact your body. There's something in between that contacts both parts, and it's your soul. And when the Bible talks about renewing our mind, it's talking about the mind that the soul has. And we have to renew our mind when we become born again, because when we got saved, all that got saved was the spirit man. One third of us. The other two thirds didn't get saved. It got redeemed. But the final redemption's not here yet. And we won't get our final redemption until Christ comes back, or we die and leave this world and go to be with Him. And when He returns, our body will be resurrected, and it'll be changed and glorified. And then we'll all will be a unit again, all together. All right? I just want to... Is that hard for anybody to see? The only way that your body can touch your spirit is through the soul. It cannot contact it otherwise. If your body contacted your spirit would be contaminated and couldn't be saved, because your body now is perfect. When you got saved and born again, totally perfect. That's what, when the scripture talks about you're perfect in Christ, that's what it's talking about. It's not your physical body, it's not your even your soul, it's your spirit that got born again, that new creature, that real you that's on the inside, that's what got totally saved, all right? So as we renew our mind, then our spirit man can begin to affect the physical outward body that we have. But until that mind is renewed, the spirit has a very hard time dealing. In fact, the Bible says that flesh against spirit, and that's where the war goes on, and the war goes on in our mind, in our soul part of us. All right? And I want to just show you this last illustration, and then we'll go into the word itself. Everybody see that little illustration there? And I like to use this because we're familiar with water flow through a pipe. And in order for our hose to get water out the end, we have to open the valve up and let it go. The faucet's got plenty of water, but nothing flows through the hose until we turn the water on. And so this illustration kind of gives us a better understanding of our soul part of us. Our spirit's perfect. It's got everything we could ever imagine in it. It was saved perfectly. All the power of God, everything is in our spirit. Even the Holy Spirit moved in when we got saved. The Holy Spirit is in there. And the beauty of it is this, the Holy Spirit moved in, and the Holy Spirit and our spirit are actually intermarried now just as one on the inside. The Bible says that you've got the greater one on the inside of you, the greater one in there than the one that's in the world.
Amen.
You've got the same Holy Spirit in you that raised Christ from the dead, and all of the theologians that actually know something about all this, not unlike me, will actually tell you that the resurrection power, the power it took to resurrect Christ and to bring Christ up out of the grave, was more power exerted than it was to create the world. Now, I don't know how you determine that, but I'll take their word for it. I'll believe that. But you've got that power on the inside of you. But the only way it can get out is through that soul. And there's something that closes that valve, and there's something that opens that valve. And the reason we don't see manifestation of it in our outward body many times is because the valve's closed. Now, we're going to go into the Word from there, and without going back and doing some of this stuff from Thursday night, you'll just have to go back and buy that tape for $45 from Jerry. And look at it. No, it's totally free. We don't charge for anything here, except my comedy. Nobody's purchased any of that yet.
But wait.
First scripture that I want you to look at tonight, probably the most important scripture that you can understand, is Philemon 1:6. Look that up, and while you're on the way to Philemon 1:6, look at John chapter 1. We'll use a verse of scripture out of there. I'm not going to read you just 1, 2, 3 out of one book. I'll make it easy for you. You're going to have to look some stuff up. If you're slow to find these scriptures, don't worry about it. I've got them already down here, and if you want a copy of all the scriptures that we go through tonight, I'll run you a copy off on the machine we got out here later, after the service. Or you can write them down and look at them later. I'm going to read them for you whether you see them or not, but I'll mention them as we go so that you'll have them. But one thing that I want to mention about this morning, and we talked about even tonight, we've talked about the tragedy, of course, that took place out in Colorado. The one thing that comes to my mind is this, and it's deception. Oh, Connecticut, I'm sorry. We did have one out there at some point in time, didn't we? Yeah, Connecticut. The one thing that really burned into my mind was this, and it's deception. Although we're in an age of grace, we're in the greatest time of Satan's deception that we'll ever be in. And the farther we get towards the coming of Christ, it says that deception will get stronger and stronger. We've got more ministers dropping out of the ministry today because they just don't believe what they've been preaching anymore. They don't even believe Christ is coming back after all the years they've taught it. Deception. Deception. Being deceived. And it is absolutely a shame, but it's reality. You might as well understand it. And Jesus said, except the days be shortened, even the elect would be deceived. So he'll shorten it when it gets too tough. All right? But if deception is our biggest problem, then we need to know what the solution is, and we need to know how to grab a hold of the solution so that we're not deceived in any way. And what the solution is knowing the reality, knowing the real thing. If you want to find counterfeit bills, they teach you how all of the good ones look like. And they teach you that so well that when you see a bad one, it's automatic. You know that's not the real thing. This is the only real thing we've got. Our five senses are not the real thing. They help our physical body. But if we're relying on what we see and we're relying on what we hear, we're going to be deceived and deceived easily. That word's the only thing that's going to keep you from not being deceived. And most Christians today are dominated by what they see, taste, hear, smell, feel, instead of that word. They're dominated by their senses. Now listen, we've got to have our senses. If it didn't, you'd touch that hot heater and it'd burn your hand and blister it. And you'd be in a mess. You got to have your senses. You got to be able to see. You got to be able to hear. You know what happens if you're blinded? Somebody has to lead you along. If you can't hear, then somebody's got to help you in that direction. If you can't touch or taste or do any of the rest of those things, there's things there. I worked in a chemical plant for 15, well, probably 30 years in different plants, but 15 years for Shell Oil Company, and that's all pure chemicals, and it just eats my smell up. Junior asked me the other day, we was driving, could I smell something in his vehicle? I said, I can't smell anything anyhow. I wouldn't know whether it was there or not. I've done burnt those things up on the real stuff. But the flow of life within... Now, we're talking about people that are dominated by the senses. When they're dominated by the senses and not by the word, that flow of life that we saw up there that goes through, it's turned off. It's turned off because they can't believe anything they can't see. Anybody from Missouri? Thank God. I say that lovingly because we've been all around. We've been in Missouri also. But that's their motto. They're the show me state. And if you can't show me, I can't believe it. We don't want to be from Missouri. I'm talking about that in a spiritual sense. I'm not talking about it in a physical sense. You don't want to be from Missouri in a spiritual sense. If you've got to see it to believe it, you'll never believe it. You'll never walk this walk of faith by being in that state. These type Christians also don't understand the change that happened in their born-again spirits or who they are in Christ. You can't understand that if you're relying on the senses instead of this word. To those people, something's not real unless it's perceived through these senses. If I can't see it, you see, that's what's the matter. That's the reason they can't grab a hold of healing, is because they have to see it or feel it first before they can believe that they've got it. And the Bible says God's economy always works absolute opposite from what this world functions in. God's economy says this: you got it whether you can see it or feel it or not. And you got to begin to believe that you got it first. And then you got to step out and respond to it. Faith is nothing more than responding to what God has already done. And His Word says He's already healed us. Word says He's already provided everything for us, Brother Gary. Everything. He supplied it all. But faith is this. It's responding to that. You can. I've heard this statement before, and I've used it myself. And by the way, I need to stop right here and apologize, because I said I would when I was in our Saturday classes, when God revealed something to me that I had said wrong. And I said, the first opportunity I get before the church, I'm going to apologize to them. So I have to stop and apologize to you, because I used to make this statement. I don't have any power in me. Don't look at me. Look upon Jesus when I'm laying hands on you. And the Lord checked me on that. He checked me several times when I said it before He finally got my attention. I'm kind of like a mule. You got to hit me with a 2x4 to get my attention. But He finally got my attention, and He said, you've got the power in you. Now that doesn't, I'm not elevating myself to some degree. Listen, I'm really humble in areas. I know who I am and where I came from, and I know what Jesus was saying when He said that. The power's in you, but then Jesus is in you. Amen. God's Spirit is on the inside of you. Amen. So don't go around confessing the fact that you don't have nothing in you. You've got everything in you.
Hallelujah.
And that's the very reason for this teaching that I'm doing here today, or tonight. The reason that I started it on Saturday is because God convicted me about it first and showed me, you've been sitting up here telling these people something that's not the truth. And if they grab a hold of that, they're not going to be able to walk in faith in their own life. So accept my apology, forgive me, and let's move on. The real truth is what we want. The Christian life isn't a process of getting from God. It's a processing of releasing what we've already got. I used a statement here not too long ago in one of these sessions. I don't remember what it was, about the dog chasing their tail. And you know what was really comical about that? I went home and we just got a little puppy, and first thing I noticed, here's that puppy chasing his tail. I told Wanda, I just confessed it right on my own dog, but we're trying to get him out of that. But sometimes we as Christians are like that. We're chasing after something, trying to get something that we already have. And that's not the process. That's not what God did. God, when we got saved, God gave us everything that we've got. The Bible says here, and we've got a verse of scripture, I'll give it to you in a moment, but it talks about a measure of faith. We've been given a measure of faith. Well, Ephesians 2:8-9 says that very thing. It says, for by grace are you saved through faith, for it is a gift of God. God gifted us with that. Otherwise, we'd have never got it anyhow, because we've been walking around. Our old man was that way, and we walked around relying on our senses. If we couldn't see it and hear it, we didn't believe it. But God says, I gave you, number one, you were saved by grace, but you were saved through faith. And not only that, it's a gift of God. He gave you a measure of faith. A measure. And the measure is all you need. He didn't get a great big measure for Brother Kevin back there, or Brother Albert, and give me a little old skinny scoop up here in myself. We all got the same measure. We got the same measure that the apostles got when they got it. When Paul or when Peter and John, when they were going there to that temple that day, they had the same measure of faith that they operated in that you and I got when we got born again. The only problem is acknowledging and understanding it and realizing that we've got to respond to it and turn it loose, but you can't turn something loose that you don't know you have. So we have to understand that we've got it. We've got to get a good understanding of it so that we know what we've got. I know that I know that I know that I'm saved. I know that I know that I know that all that power is residing in me, and any time that I need it, I can turn it loose for whatever situation. But then Paul tells us over in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, that we've got to renew our mind. Because our mind's not been renewed. It didn't get renewed when I got saved. I got the same old mind when I came up as I went down with. If I was stupid when I went down, I'm stupid when I got up. That didn't change a bit. So I've got to renew this thing and get some understanding. I don't want man's understanding. I want understanding of what this word says so that I can find out, because this is my mirror. This is what's going to tell me who I am. So I got to get God's understanding inside of me. But even that is not what renewing the mind is talking about. That's where for so long I struggled and I wondered and I didn't understand, because so many people can quote this word and quote this word and quote this word, but yet they weren't getting the manifestation. The valve wasn't getting open. They wasn't getting the flow through, and it wasn't coming out into their physical life. And that's when God showed me, and I began to understand, and through study, the fact that the senses, and if we're relying on our senses, if we're relying on what we see and hear, it keeps the valve closed. And you can quote all this word, confess all this word, say all this word you want. But you know what? When it comes down to the real bread and butter here, Brother Gary, and I got to use it because somebody needs healing, and if I'm looking to see some results on that individual, or I'm listening for that individual to say, yeah, I got it, I got it, I got it, and they say, no, the pain's still there, then automatically I'm resorting back. I default back to those senses. And I voided everything. The valve's closed. You'll get nothing out. You got to keep straight. You got to rely on what the word says. Regardless of what you see. Regardless of what you hear. You've got to get it in your heart and believe it. Confess it out of your mouth. It's the same for healing. It's the same for finances. It's the same for family problems as it was whenever you got salvation. And when you got salvation, somebody got the word to you. You got the word somehow. You might have read it out of a book yourself. You might have saw it on TV. Or somebody might have spoke it to you. But you had the word to rely on. And the reason you got saved was this. God was tugging at your heart, number one. Nobody comes to Him except He pulls them. Amen. He tugs you. And you know when He's tugging. Because you're hanging on. You're hanging on to the old life and don't want to turn it loose. And so as we sit back and hang on to the pew and we don't want to turn it loose, and God's tugging at our heart and we've heard the word. Now listen, the only difference in the old way we operated and what is fixing to happen when we respond to that, when we get up out of the pew and begin to come forward, just that instantly, wasn't much of a snap, sorry. But just that instantly, things begin to happen in you. You get saved. That old man moved out, and their brand new man is placed inside of you. The Holy Spirit is placed inside of you. All the power of God is placed inside of you. And it was all because you responded to what God had already done. Jesus did it on the cross. Amen. Your faith was the measure that He gave you, and you responded to it. It's no different for healing, finances, whatever else that you're going across in your life. Look at me with Philemon 1:6. I'm sure you're there by now. That verse says that the communication of, I'm going to skip a little King James words here, the communication of your faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Communication means this. It means to release or transfer. Whenever we pray for somebody, we call God, God moves upon our heart to have a healing line, and somebody comes up, it's a release or transfer into that individual. Whether they've got the faith or not, doesn't make any difference. Brother Gary, when you lay hands on that individual, believing that God, it's transferred into that individual. And we don't respond by what we see, we don't respond by what we hear, we don't respond by what they say that they feel, we respond by the fact of what that word says, is that when I lay hands on that individual, they got it.
Amen.
And be quite honest with you, I'm going on somewhere else, I'm either going back up here or to another individual, I don't want to hear anything that person's got to say unless they're jumping, praising God and thanking Him for the healing that they just got. Because if they tell me they didn't get it, I'm not going to be, you need to go sit down and come back later on after you've got some more teaching. But it says the release or transfer, that's what that communication, the release or the transfer of your faith, the release or the transfer of your response to what God has already done. That's what that is. It's nothing to do with you. You've got it, and you need to release it, and let it go, and let it be transferred, that it may become effectual. Now, here's the word. Get a hold of this effectual. That word means it begins to work, or produce, or be cooperative, or be operative. Now, begin to look at that now. That the release of my response of what God has already done makes it begin to work and become effective. Never tell somebody they can do something without telling them how. The reason why? God never does. How do we do that? How do we release that or transfer that response, that faith, so that it becomes operative and works and produces in somebody's life? Look at that verse. The verse has got the answer. By the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you. In you where? In your spirit. Already in you. In Christ Jesus. It's all because of what's already in you, in Christ Jesus. Jesus said when He prayed back in John 17, He prayed for His disciples, and He prayed for all those that would follow them. That goes all the way down to the end of time. And He said, Father, that they would be one as You and I are one. How were they one? Jesus told His own disciples, He said, everything that I say, everything that I do, all the works that you see me do, they're not really me. That's the Father doing that. That's how close we are. If you want to know the Father, look at what I've done. You want to know Jesus? Look at what a Christian does that's working in this very thing. That's got a hold of this revelation knowledge and is releasing it out to those that they come into contact with. You'll see Jesus. All the gifts of the Spirit should be operating in every individual. I'm talking about love, joy, peace, gentleness, kindness, all those things. Why? Because that's what Jesus is. His Holy Spirit's on the inside of us. And if we see anything, in fact, Jesus told us, you want to know who the brethren are? Look at those that love the brethren. If they don't have the love for the brethren on the inside of them, then obviously they're not of the brethren. That's how we judge. That's the only way we can judge. We can judge with what God's Word says. But it makes it so simple. It's not a difficult thing for us. So I can release or transfer my faith. My faith being a response. What I actually do in response to what God has already done. And when I do that, it will become operative and produce into whatever area I'm releasing it into. It may be into my own life. It might be into my own finances. It might be into my own body. Or I can release it into somebody else. Under the new covenant, we've all, everybody, past tense, not something future. Here's the problem. We got saved, and if you come out of a denominational church like I did, then you basically go back and you sit on the pew, pay your tithes, attend regularly, do whatever kind of work we need you to do in the church, and someday, in the sweet by and by, we'll all go to our mansion in the sky. What in the world do we do here now while we're here? What are we still here for? You'd have been better off if God would have just took you the very moment that you got saved and zapped you out of here, and then you wouldn't have to deal with none of this other stuff. We're in a real world. We're in a real battle. It's a day-to-day battle. And there's something that we've got to do, and our part is this. Our part is renewing our mind to the things of this Word. It's a process that starts whenever we got saved. It's a process that'll never end until Jesus comes back. We'll renew and release. And renew and release. Because when you get renewed in this area here, and oh, praise God, I've got it. Guess what? God will show you something else. Now you need to step up another notch. You need to kick it up a notch. He says He'll take us from glory to glory. You won't be the same next week, next month, next year that you are today. You'll never be the same. It's a constant process. As we grab a hold of one thing, one little nugget, if we could just grab one nugget, Sister Jennifer, I'm glad you grabbed a hold of that one nugget that come from last week, Thursday night. And everlasting life and eternal life is two different things. Everybody's going to live everlastingly. But eternal life determines where you're going to spend it at. And the thing about it, when we got born again, we got eternal life on the inside of us. It'll never be taken away from you. He says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. It'll be with you from now on. And now I want you to go out and I want you to take this word that I left with you, that instruction manual, and I want you to read it. And I want you to begin to renew your mind. And I want you to get to a place to where you can get away from these senses. And what you see and what you hear is not going to affect you. It doesn't make you a cold Christian when you turn on the news and see that 28 people got killed in a little schoolyard, and most of them were kindergartners and preschoolers. I was not shocked. And I'm going to tell you why. Because I know there's a deceiver in this world. He operates evil, and I'm going to tell you what, he's around us all the time. But we are the ones that have the power over him, and if we will begin to grab a hold and operate in the power that we've got, the scripture, James, is just so simple. Submit yourselves to God. How are you going to submit to God? Renew your mind. Renew your mind. Understand who you are and begin to walk in who you are. And what this word says, this is our mirror. You don't know who you are until you look on the inside. It doesn't make any difference if you can read that thing or not. Just come sit in somebody's service and listen to them read it. God, if you pursue Him, He says if you hunger and thirst after Him, you will be filled. Now listen, that's a promise of God. You cannot hunger after God and not be filled. If it was possible, God would have to be a liar. And He says, I'm not a man that I should lie. You will be filled. Most Christians believe God can do anything, but they experience very little of it. And the reason why is that very thing. Did I read John 1:16? I'm going to, again. It says, and of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace, favor for favor. Now that doesn't mean, it's not like the world's favor. You pat me on the back and I'll pat you on the back. No, that's not what God's talking about here. You've got God's favor. When we started these studies back over in the old church on Saturdays, first thing that God led us to was old covenant, covenant, blood covenant relationships. And I taught him that. And the first thing that we understood in there was the fact that when God cut the covenant with Abraham, Abraham had nothing to do with it. God told him to go get the animals, and that was it. Abraham took it on his own to kill them, cut them in half, spread them out like they were supposed to be. Why? Because they understood covenant. They understood blood covenant. But God didn't tell him to do that. He just said, you go get the animals and bring them here. Now, you can read that back over in Genesis. And immediately God saw, you know what? This guy's going to get his hand involved in this. That's just man's way. We're going to jump in and mess things up. So what I got to do is put Abraham out of the picture. And it says that God put him to sleep. Now, he wasn't asleep like you and I know sleep, because God, Abraham said he saw what was going on. He saw two men walking the covenant walk. Somebody in his place. And you and I have come up into culture, and most of the churches, especially denominational, have taught that culture for a reason. It's called works. They want you to get involved. You've got to perform. I call it performance Christianity. I grew up in it. It put me in a nut house. The 9th floor of St. Joseph's Hospital in Houston, Texas. Locked up ward. All because I felt like I hadn't performed enough. My Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for ever even believing any of that, Lord. And God began to show me. He said, you made a mess of this vessel. Well, what was the mess? I've worked. I've done everything that I can. That's exactly the mess that I made out of it. I tried to perform for what I had. It's not about performance. Not about anything that you do. God doesn't need you. Well, listen, there's volunteer work around the church. That's not what I'm talking about. But if you do the volunteer work, and I'll be quite honest with you, if you put your money in the plate to try to get favor from God, you're throwing your money away. Now, we'll spend it, won't we, Daisy? Somewhere. We'll use it. But it ain't going to do you no good. The offering's not just for the church, just to pay the bills and just to have money to buy stuff with. It's also for your blessing.
Amen.
But you have to give it in the right attitude. If you're giving it for performance, if you're giving it for somebody to see you, and if you're giving it trying to get favor with God, you're giving it for the wrong reason. And I've done got off the lesson here. Well, let me step back over here. According to these little charts that we saw, we're one-third complete. The only part of us that's complete and perfect is our spirit man. The other two-thirds of us is not complete. The soul, the more that we get into the Word, the more that we study the Word, the more that the mind gets renewed, the closer it is. And then it begins to side with the spirit. And the spirit and the soul began to affect the body, and we began to see manifestations coming out in the body. We began to walk in a better walk. We began to have a better attitude toward others. We're more able to lay hands on the sick and see them recover because we understand what the Word says. We're able to walk in prosperity and in health and in social life. Our families will operate better if we teach them what we're getting. But there's another word here, and I want to make sure you get this, and I know that our time's getting short, and I want to try to throw some of this in. In Romans 8:6, it says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." Now, I was always taught that carnal Christian was just a sinful Christian. That was somebody that got saved and, you know, they didn't quite get all the way in, and therefore they, you know, they come to church on Sundays and went out to the bar on Saturday night, and so they was just kind of rocking, sitting on the fence. And listen, all that is untrue. All right? If you looked at this chart up here, you're either saved or you're not saved. There ain't no half in and half out. Now, you may be not manifesting what most people want to see, the holiness of God in your lives. But it's simply because your mind's not been renewed yet, and you're not releasing what's on the inside of you. And the more and more your mind it gets renewed, the more and more you'll be able to release it. Carnal Christian, carnal mindedness that it talks about in this verse, carnal simply means of the five senses, sensual. It just means a Christian that came up, moved by God, got saved, and they're still relying on the senses. And the church is full of them. Did you hear what I said? The church is full of them. They're not unsaved. The reason they're carnal minded is because they're still relying on the senses. Every one of us falls into that category a little bit in some way, and we're all in a process of getting out of that and putting the senses to rest so that we don't live this death that it's talking about. This is not the death, physical death, like you and I. We're not just going to kill over dead because you done something wrong. That death is inclusive. Here's what death's progressive effects has in it, involved in it. Sadness. That's an effect of death. Loneliness, bitterness, illness, anger, poverty. All of those are inclusive of death's progressive effects. Now listen, if you have all those operating in your life and operate long enough, eventually you'll die, physically. It will just eat you down. When Proverbs talks about laughter is a medicine, laughter maketh merry like a medicine. And that's exactly it. Happy people aren't as stressful as those that have all the rest of this stuff. And what that verse says, when we said Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death. In other words, to be carnally minded, to be operating in the senses rather than relying on the word, is going to bring all these things on you. Sadness, loneliness, bitterness, illness, anger, poverty. How do I know then if I'm not where I should be? If I'm dealing with any of those things, obviously, there's something else needs to be cleared up in my mind. And I need to get in God's word and find out what it is. But it says to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Don't you just hate those Christians that, oh boy, everybody gets laid off and they get laid off and everybody else is bawling and squalling because they lost their job and that guy's just so happy he goes out and gets in his car, I think I'm going fishing. They used to make me sick, to be honest with you, until I became one of them. Now, I didn't care if I got laid off or not. Some of them, I helped them out. I just went ahead and left. Don't do like, grow, church, grow, don't do like I did. Spiritual minded, when we become spiritual minded, we rest. There's a rest that we can, that's what Hebrews chapter 4 is talking about. You can move over into a rest, and when all those things, when you're in rest, when you have the peace of God flowing on the inside of you, and you've come to that place of rest, it means when all these things are going down all around you, and all the circumstances are falling apart around you, and everything looks like it's going to hell in a handbasket, it just don't bother you at all. You're at peace. You can't explain it. You can't pay your bills, may have to move out, move under a tree. But for some reason or other, you're singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. You're at peace. Well, let me clarify that just a minute, because I believe if you're spiritually minded enough to be over into the rest area, you're not going to be worried about none of that stuff before. And Satan knows that he can't bother you with it, so he ain't even going to try. And you're going to walk in all these. You're going to walk in prosperity. Prosperity is not being rich and living in a mansion on a hill. God doesn't have a problem with that. I mean, if God gives you the wealth to do that, praise God for you. I don't hold money against nobody. I wish everybody in the church was all millionaires.
Amen.
Then you could change these light bulbs. You'd have somebody else that you paid to do it. Yeah, a new ladder anyhow would work for us, wouldn't it? The word says this. Actually, Jesus said this. He said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The words that he's talking about is this right here. They're spirit and they're life. They'll bring life into your body. And no matter how hard the situation gets, that's the only thing that we can rely on. That's the only thing. Let me say this one little thing about feelings here, and I'm going to close out. Because we all have feelings. You can't do away with those feelings. But this is the best illustration that I've heard and that I could come up with. And feelings, you know, you got a train out here, you've got a big engine out front and maybe some cars in between, and you got a caboose on the end. They still have a few cabooses, not too many. They're doing away with those, but just bear with me and think about it in the day when we did have them. But our feelings are the caboose. They're not the engine. Our feelings don't drive this thing. They're not where we get our power from. They're the caboose trailing on the end. Feelings serve a purpose in our life. Every one of us has got feelings. But here's the catch. Your feelings were designed to follow what you think, not to lead you the way you're supposed to go. And if we haven't renewed our mind and we're relying on these senses and all the circumstances that go on around us and all the things that's in the news and all the bad stuff in the world, if that's what we're relying on and that's what we're letting affect us, our feelings are going to be leading us. And if the caboose is leading the train, you're either going the wrong way or you're headed for a crash, one or the other. Our spirit man, along with this word, is our guide. I spoke to somebody talking today about a situation about you get a check in your spirit. God will check you. I had another lesson. I really had a hard time, and I told them Saturday that we were going to be getting the same word tonight that we taught in the Saturday Bible study, because I started this last Thursday. This is the last one you'll get out of the Saturday Bible studies in here, by the way. You'll get something fresh next time I speak or whoever speaks. But you won't be getting this, because this will just be taught in the Bible study. You can still get it. It's on DVDs and it's on the internet somehow. You can get with Jerry and figure that out, how you do that. But I want to just mention one last thing, and I want to leave you with a question tonight. God woke me up at 1:38 in the morning here several weeks ago. I don't even remember when it was now. I believe I told Brother Raymond about it one morning we were sitting out here. But God woke me up and he said, why not? It was because of some things that I had been dealing with, questions. Why? we're in this building and all this, and we got plenty of room, and Lord, what are we doing here? And if you've ever been around me very long, you'll know that there's three things that I'm constantly looking for. And if you ever read one of my books, which I don't allow those to go out too often to too many people, because I write in my books. They're mine. I write in them. I write in my Bible. But there's three things that God began to deal with me in 1992. Who are you? What are you doing here? And where are you going? And when he woke me up that morning and said, why not? I knew what he was talking about. And I said, yeah, why not? Why not, Brother Albert, that people can't jump out of their wheelchairs here? It's happened in the past. It still happens today, all over the world. Why not? Why not? Why not here? Why not? It's what God was dealing with me on. Why not that we can't see? Why not can't the whole congregation be in total health? Why not? It's not a lack of God's power. Why not? Now, I'm telling you that it eats me up to know that we've got something, but we're not quite there yet. But we're on the brink. We're on the brink. And I'll be very honest with you. It's my prayer that somebody, Brother Pat sings that song all the time. I wish somebody would catch on fire. I wish somebody would get a hold of this teaching. I wish the whole church would get a hold of this teaching. And I'm going to tell you what, when we do get a hold of this teaching and begin to release what we've already got on the inside, you're going to find that it's a walk of life. It's everywhere that you are. You begin to walk in it. You begin to see things differently because you begin to look from God's economy. You begin to hear from God's economy and not from the way that the world is dealing out here.
Amen.
And things take a different perspective on you. And you have a different peace and joy on the inside.
Amen.
Doesn't make any difference what's coming down. Doesn't make any difference what kind of finances that you got. It doesn't make any difference what that board says over there. It's got nothing to do with God's economy. We began to walk in it, and we're going to see some things happen, and people are going to take notice of it. Why not? Why not, Brother Howard? Why not? Well, why not, Sister Jennifer? Why not here? I ache for it. I go to bed at night with it. I get up in the morning. Why not? All it takes is us releasing what God has already done. He'll operate in our lives. I hope I get to speak next Sunday night. I know we're going to have a deal Thursday. I hope I get to speak next Thursday night. Sunday night. Some night. Some night. I want to see how much we've grabbed a hold of. If we only got one little nugget out of it, would be all it would take to set us on fire.
Amen.
It's contagious. When you grab a hold of it, it gets contagious inside of you. It spills over on others, Brother Gary, and they get excited about it, and everybody gets excited about it, and God gets excited about it. It says the angels in heaven get excited about it. And if one person got saved, wouldn't it be worth it all? If we could, you know, if one person got saved and we had to close this thing down, it would have been worth it all.
Amen.
It would have been worth everything.
Amen.
Now, that's not going to happen. I believe the one's going to get saved. I believe there's some others that's going to get saved. There's going to be some people get healed. We're going to see some miracles on the inside of here because God wants that. That's what he put us here for. That's why we're here, and that's what's going to happen. If we'll just turn it loose and let him do it.
Thank you,
amen. God bless you, Sister Daisy. You got it.